Welcome to The Abyss. I'm Jacqueline, and today we're discussing atmospheric circulation. This is the first in a three-part series on how the ocean currents work. Let's dive in. Atmospheric circulation is the large-scale patterns of how air moves around the Earth's atmosphere. Air, just like everything else, has mass and therefore density. An air mass is a term used to describe a large body of air that has uniform density. It is the varying densities of different air masses that causes the air to circulate, with air masses moving higher or lower until they are surrounded by air of the same density. Multiple factors can affect the density of an air mass, including temperature, pressure, and humidity. Warming an air mass or applying less pressure will cause the air to expand. This means the same amount of air now takes up more space, giving it a lower density. This will cause the air mass to rise. Oppositely, cooling an air mass or applying more pressure will result in the air mass becoming denser and causing it to sink. Pressure can also determine how an air mass will move because air will move from an area of high pressure to an area of low. Humidity also has an effect on the density of an air mass. This is because water vapor is lighter than the oxygen molecules and nitrogen molecules that make up the majority of the atmosphere. This means an air mass with a high humidity will be lighter and less dense. The heating of the Earth and its atmosphere by the sun is not uniform. Since the Earth is a sphere and tilted on its axis, different airs experience different amounts of solar radiation depending on the time of year and the latitude. The equator experiences the most direct light and is therefore the hottest. Areas farther away from the equator receive light at an angle. This means the light is spread out over a larger area and is more likely to be reflected. This uneven heating of the Earth results in the atmosphere circulating in convection cells. Convection cells can occur in both gases and liquids and can be demonstrated by water circulating in a tank. When heat is added to the water, it will expand and begin to rise. This leaves an area of low pressure behind. Adjacent water will then rush in to fill this area of low pressure. Once the rising water hits a ceiling, it moves laterally and begins to cool, becoming denser and therefore starting to sink. This same process occurs with air circulation in the Earth's atmosphere. The air at the equator receives the most direct sunlight and is therefore heated to a higher temperature than the surrounding air masses. The air then rises and diverges once it reaches the top of the troposphere, which is the lower atmosphere. Once it diverges, the air moves laterally towards the poles. Colder, denser air from the poles then moves in to replace the air that rose at the equator. In this model, there are two convection cells, one in each hemisphere. However, this model is a simplification that does not take the Earth's rotation into consideration. Once this is accounted for, atmospheric circulation becomes much more complicated. This is because of the Coriolis effect. The Coriolis effect describes the tendency of an object moving on a rotating plane to be deflected from its path. This deflection is either to the left or to the right, depending on if the rotating plane is moving clockwise or counterclockwise. On the Earth, this results in objects moving from the equator to be deflected to the right in the northern hemisphere and to the left in the southern hemisphere. The Coriolis effect can be demonstrated by drawing a straight line from the center of a spinning object to the outer edge. From our point of view, the marker moves in a straight path. However, from the point of view of the spinning plane, the marker moved along a curved path. The same effect occurs as air masses move through the Earth's atmosphere. As air moves from the equator, it is deflected more and more from its path. The Coriolis effect is zero at the equator, but increases as you move towards the poles. The degree of deflection depends on how fast an object is moving and the distance the object travels. Objects moving too quickly or over a small distance will be deflected by a negligible amount. Therefore, the Coriolis effect is only noticeable on objects moving slowly over a large distance, such as air and ocean currents over the Earth. The Coriolis effect is often mistakenly used to state that a flushing toilet spins in opposite directions in the northern and southern hemispheres. However, water in a toilet spins too quickly and over such a small area that it is not affected by the Coriolis effect. This effect, however, does explain why large storms such as hurricanes and cyclones spin in opposite directions in the two hemispheres. It also explains why these large storms don't cross the equator. When we factor the Coriolis effect into our convection cell model, instead of one cell in each hemisphere, we end up with three. These are the Hadley, Farrell, and Polar cells. The Hadley cells are the ones closest to the equator, the Farrell cells occupy the mid-latitudes, and the polar cells are the ones closest to the poles. This model can now be used to accurately describe the general wind patterns observed on Earth. Similar to our first model, air rises at the equator due to the unequal heating of the Earth's surface. As it diverges, air moving into the northern hemisphere gets deflected to the right, and air moving into the southern hemisphere gets deflected to the left. This creates a band of low pressure around the equator. Air then rushes in to fill this area, creating the northeast trade winds in the northern hemisphere and the southeast trade winds in the southern hemisphere. At 30 degrees latitude, the air that rose at the equator has lost enough heat and humidity that it begins to sink. Since most of the humidity is lost, the land beneath this area is very dry and explains why the majority of the Earth's deserts are found at this latitude. The air that has sunk then diverges and moves to the north and to the south. The air that moves towards the poles curves west because of the Coriolis effect. This wind is the prevailing westerlies. The westerlies explain why the majority of the weather systems in the United States and Canada move from the west to the east. Lastly, at about 60 degrees latitude, the westerlies encounter air from the poles that is much colder. This causes the air to rise. The air then moves towards the poles, where it begins to sink and cool. This creates another very dry area with high atmospheric pressure, similar to the ones at 30 degrees latitude. This high pressure forces the air away from the poles and creates the polar easterly winds. This three-cell model accurately describes the main patterns of atmospheric circulation. However, the continents can break up the convection cells, affecting air movements and the weather patterns. Besides these continental effects, there are also seasonal differences in the convection cells. This means there are variations from our three-cell model depending on the time of year and the geography. That is how atmospheric circulation works. Stay tuned for part two to see how this affects the surface ocean currents. Leave any comments or questions down below, and until next tide, I will see you later.